You ready? The forgetfulness quiz. Here we go. Just a few questions for you. First one, as we look at this, I don't know if how many of you guys struggle with this, but I do. I am super, super forgetful. That's just how I am. So how forgetful are you? Am I the only one? Let's check this out. First one is this. Have you ever gone shopping just to return home having bought everything except the reason you went shopping for? Oh, look at that. Yeah, quite a few. Good, I'm not alone. The next one, have you ever driven home and then became afraid that you might not have stopped at that intersection a while back because you have no idea how you got home? Okay. Yeah, you've done that. Okay, cool. I'm not alone. Have you ever been unable to find your car when done shopping? Wow, we got a forgetful bunch. This is awesome. Have you ever, when cooking, burnt your food? Oh, look at that. Doing pretty good. One more question. You ready? Here it is. Last one. This is the biggie. What was the first question I asked you? Anybody willing to shout? Go ahead. Go ahead. What was it? Oh, you're saying you forgot. Anybody remember? What was the first question I asked? Anybody remember? Anybody? Nope, that's not it. The first question is, how forgetful are you? That was literally my first question. I knew I'd get someone on that. But here's the thing. As we increase in stress in our life, as we increase our exhaustion level, our forgetfulness increases as well. The higher our difficulty in life, the higher our forgetfulness. That's what's going to happen. That's what happens to the disciples here. A storm is going to rock them, and they're going to have the potential of being forgetful. Forgetful of who God is. Forgetful that Jesus might be able to help. Forgetful of how Jesus might even be relevant. Forgetful of how God's been faithful in the past. And they're going to be filled with anxiety, turmoil, additional stress, because that's what happens. We are great, solid people until hard times hit. Then suddenly we forget how to act like an adult. Suddenly we forget what it means to be mature. Suddenly we forget all the things that we know will help. We seem to become totally forgetful. So what my hope is to give us enough things that we could write down that when those times hit, we can refer back to it because we will have forgotten. So hopefully you got a pen, you're going to write these down so that when the time comes that you might be tempted to forget, you'll be able to step back, look at that and say, yes, I remember and I have to be intentional about that because I have a tendency to forget, especially when it's hard. So the disciples are about to getting into a boat. Jesus had just gone through a big old ordeal. He had been preaching to people, talking to people. He had fed over 5,000 with people. Okay, and so that's the context of this. And we're also going to find out that this is the second storm that the disciples are going to go through. The first storm recorded in Scripture was where Jesus fell asleep on the boat. And the disciples are like, God, why are you sleeping? Get up, help us. And Jesus is like, man, you guys have small faith. And so now they're going to have another storm. And are they going to remember the first one? I mean, after all, it was just like 6 chapters ago, right? Okay, a lot more time has gone by than just 6 chapters, but nonetheless, it was a while ago, but will they remember or will they struggle? And so after Jesus fed the 5,000, he originally wanted alone time. That was what he was doing. He was going off somewhere to pray and to spend some alone time when thousands of people, over 5,000, 5,000 men, and in addition to that, women and children, were huddled around him, were following him. They were hungry. The disciples were like, Jesus, there's a Taco Bell like way, way far away, and let them go there. Let them go to that place and get something to eat. Okay, Taco Bell wasn't open yet. So Burger King is older. And so let them go to Burger King and let them eat there. And Jesus is like, you know what? No, let's gather them. Let's feed them. And we can do it. So he said, whatever you got, feed them. And they're like, dude, we don't even have enough food for us. There's 13 of us. We got 5 bread. We got 2 fish. They're not even big fish. They might as well be sardines. You know, Peter didn't do too good today. And so he said he caught 6 inches, but you know how Peter's is on telling the truth. And so we don't have enough even for today. And Jesus said, feed them. And so they did. And there was even food left over. Miracle. Okay, because sometimes the task is huge, the resources are small, and we can't meet the need, and it takes a miracle to do it. And fortunately, Jesus shows time and time again, he's interested in being a miracle worker. Now he's really, really wants alone time because he's exhausted. Now, I've ever had it that when you want alone time, that's when people keep bothering you. And it gets really hard to just find that moment where you can just, in a loving way, say, shut up and leave me alone. Somehow, there's got to be loving words for that. Jesus couldn't find any words to say that. So he did an action that does that. Check this out. It's really neat. So immediately after feeding everybody, verse 22, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side. So disciples, get in the boat, sail across the lake. Okay, real simple. While he dismissed the crowd. Basically, show's over, folks, go home. After he had dismissed them, where did he go? He went up a mountainside by himself to pray. Okay, these mountainsides are vicious. Okay, people die climbing these mountainsides in this area. They are vicious mountainsides. Jesus just works his way up, and he goes there because anybody that would want to follow him are going to look at the mountain and go, forget it. I'm going home. Jesus is going where I can't go. Okay, I know you wish you had one of those in your house, right? Just that place that when kids hear it, they see that you go, they go, forget it. I'm not going in there. And there isn't a place. Even the bathroom isn't sacred. My kids go under the door and they start peeking. But daddy, what you doing under there? And this hand comes under. Okay, so even my bathroom's not sacred. And so, but Jesus found this great place where he can go by himself to pray. Later that night, as the verses continue, he was there alone and the boat was already a considerable distance from land. I know some people go, how far from land? Well, the tape measure didn't quite reach. Okay, so we don't know the exact distance, but they're out into the sea, okay? So they're a considerable distance from land. What that usually means is, standing at the shore, you can't see the boat. Okay, that's how far out they are. They are a considerable distance. If you're standing at the shore, you're standing somewhere, and you look out at the sea, you're not seeing the boat. Okay, so they're a great distance from land, and the ship was buffeted, was being tormented, was being battered by the waves because the wind was against it. So a mighty storm rushes up, comes in, and starts threatening the integrity of the boat, starts minimizing the skill of the workers and of the people who have lived on the sea. Okay, these are mostly fishermen. There's a few that aren't, and they're the ones that are screaming, you know, the high-pitched scream. But meanwhile, the other fishermen are like, come on, just do this. And they're doing whatever they can, but it's not working. Okay, they're really struggling with it, really struggling with it. And the wind is against it. So this big storm comes up and is buffeting them, is battering them, and is absolutely attacking them. That's the situation. That's our scenario. That's our foundation that we have to build on. From here, I would like to offer seven brief storm observations. Okay, observations that I would recommend that you would write down because they will be so helpful when the storms hit your life on a metaphorical level and in some cases, depending on natural disasters, literal. Okay, so I'd like to look at this historical event and make metaphorical applications for you to try to remember when the storms threaten your boat, your life, your home, your safety, your sanity, whatever it might be. Okay, in case you're wondering what the difference between a storm and difficulties are, because sometimes people say, storm's hitting my life, when really it's just hardship or difficulty. Difficulty means you can actually manage it. You can work with it. You don't know what to do at first, but you can figure it out. And give yourself a couple days, you navigate it. Storm is you do everything you can possibly do to handle it, and the storm still rages, and there's nothing you can do. And you are at your wit's end. You've tried every part of your expertise and it has all failed. That's a storm. Okay, so that's kind of what we're looking at here is the storm is absolutely raging. And a couple of observations for you, seven specifically. Check this out. Number one, storms are encountered in obedience to Christ. Storms are encountered in obedience to Christ. Check it out. The disciples were told to go into what? A boat. Where did they go? In a boat. The disciples were told by Jesus to go where? To the other side. Where are they headed to? The other side. They cannot be more in the center of God's will. It is impossible for them to be more obedient than they are at this moment. Think of just the logistics of this. Okay, Jesus says, hey, get in the boat. Okay, Jesus. Okay, go out to sea. Okay, that is sheer, pure obedience. They cannot be more in the center of God's will, and still the storm threatened them. And how often it is when hardships hit our lives, we think some reason the storm is about punishment. We think for some reason that it is about God mad at us or something going wrong because of us. And if it's not that, we think we don't deserve the storm. We start saying, why, God, is this happening to me when I have done everything you've asked me to do to the best of my ability, and still, this is how I'm thanked? This is how I'm treated? This is the consequence I get for right behavior, hardship, and disaster? And before you start thinking, well, no one would ever say that, I actually experienced that of our congregation on a weekly basis, where something really bad happens in my home, and people will say something to the effect of, wow, I wouldn't think that happened to a pastor after all that you go through and all that you do. Why would that happen to you? Well, because storms come even when you're in obedience. And who said I've been fully obedient that week? Because I screw up and sin too. So here's the thing about storms. Storms have a PU factor. Every storm has a PU factor. In that, first, they all stink. Okay, so PU. But secondly, they usually have one of two purposes to them. One, they are a punishment. See, PU, punishment. Okay, so one, they could be a punishment for wrong behavior and God's trying to get you back on track. Or two, they could be a push. Because you're already being obediently faithful, and God's trying to push that to go even further. So next time a storm hits your life, you could always ask yourself, punishment or push? Either way, how do you get your life more on track during the storm toward God? Okay, but keep in mind that even when you are fully obedient, storms can and will still hit you and come your way. Secondly, storms should remind us of God's promises. Every storm should remind us of God's promises. Check this out. Jesus told the disciples to go where? To the other side. Which means if Jesus says you're going to go to the other side, where does that mean you're going to go? To the other side. Okay, and so when they're going and everything's hitting them and they start doubting, wondering what are we going to do, it's like they completely forgot what God had already promised them. Of course, that was God's promise and Jesus' promise to the disciples regarding a boat. Do we have promises, anything like that? That is for our day today that the Bible has given us. And while there are several, let me just give you one very important one that I have found to be the most helpful in times of storms that is easy to forget. Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39 says this, that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities or powers or governing authorities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing is able to separate us from the love of God. Which means no matter what it is you're going through, no matter who is coming after you, you are never alone. God is never abandoning you, and you are always in His hands, period. That's the promise. Of all the promises in Scripture, this one's a great one to hang on to. To remind yourself, if you think taxes are hitting you hard, and you say, woe is me, why is the government hating me so? Keep in mind, you are in the hands of God. If you are thinking, why is it that the college campus is criticizing me and my faith? Keep in mind, you're still in the hands of God. If you have a problem with your boss, you have a problem with your spouse, you have a problem with your kids, your parents, whatever's going on, keep in mind, nothing that's going to happen is going to separate you from God. He is going to be with you and present with you and carrying you in His hands the entire time. But how easy it is for us to forget that. Because we tend to say, oh, woe is me. And we focus on the strength of the storm rather than on the strength of the Savior. And we completely go totally internal in our battle. And we start saying, this is my problem. I'm all alone. Nobody understands. Nobody cares. Parents just don't understand. My friends just understand. My problem is unique. My problem is original. My problem is special. I'm the exception to the rule. And inward they spiral downward like a corkscrew into the dirt. And we need this verse to remind us that God is with us the entire time. is with us the entire time. So storms should remind us of God's promises. No matter how violent the storm gets, God's love is still present. But we're just started here. We're just going. Number three, even while God appears to be out of our sight, we are never out of his. Check this out. Verse 25 as the verse continues. So the boat is where? Considerable distance out to the sea, where if you're standing at the shore, you're not able to see the boat. You think they can see Jesus up on the mountainside from where they're at? Absolutely not. Jesus is out of their sight. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. How did he know where to go? Because even though he's out of their sight, they are not out of his. God knows where you are, no matter how dark it gets, no matter how rough it gets. He knows exactly where your little boat is. And we need to be reminded of that from time to time, that God knows exactly where we are. But sometimes the stress gets so hard that we just think that God has forgotten us. That we think that somehow God is not aware, which brings us to four, that God remembers us, especially in our darkest hour. That he remembers us, especially in our darkest hour. And it's neat that it said that he went out. It was basically, it's 3 a.m. if you want the exact time of that fourth watch, or in the middle of the night, or just before dawn, or however that translation is you have when Jesus is walking out on the water. Okay, whatever that is, it is about 3 a.m. That is the darkest part of night. It's the darkest hour. And there's a little thing that I found out throughout Scripture. Check this out. There is something that one day maybe I'll have to put this on a blog or publish it or something. This is really neat. I call it the remembrance of God. That God remembers during the darkest time. So check this out. Throughout Scripture, there's a repeated phrase. It's a weird phrase. It says, and God remembered. And it's there like a half a dozen times in the Old Testament alone. For example, Genesis chapter 8, verse 1, when Noah was in the ark and the animals were in the ark and the whole world was flooded and dead bodies were bouncing up against the edge of the thing. They were hearing the animals calling out for air and all of a sudden gurgling and everything became strangely silent. And it's the darkest thing you could ever imagine happening, one of the darkest parts of history, not a children's story. Okay, it is the death of all things. People banging, pleading, open the door, open the window, hearing the gurgling, and then a silence. And then hearing occasionally the bump, bump against the hull of the ship. Okay, on and on, the darkness goes. And there they are, the only people left on the planet, the only animals left on the planet, and floating on the water. And then right in the middle of that, at the darkest point, chapter 8, verse 1, it says, and God remembered Noah and the animals. And God remembered. Or in Genesis 19:29, where Abraham is going through a dark time and he's wondering when a kid's going to come of God's promise, and he's forgetting God's promise. He's forgetting God's faithfulness. He's doubting it. He knows what God said, but he's not sure if God's going to carry it through. He's being completely tortured within himself. His wife is being of no help. She's griping and complaining. And during one of his darkest hours, it says, verse 29 of chapter 19, and God remembered Abraham. Or that when the Israelites are dealing with the slavery in Egypt, and there they are suffering and calling out saying, God, where are you? Exodus 2:24, and God remembered Israel and the covenant. And when Hannah was dealing with barrenness and her husband's other wife is teasing her, mocking her, belittling her, she goes to the temple to pray and she says, God, why won't you intervene? Why won't you intercede? Why can I not get pregnant? Why are people hating me so? How can I be a faithful wife to my husband when I can't fulfill this duty? That's all he wants and is all I can't offer. What do I do, God? 1 Samuel 1:19, and God remembered Hannah, and on it goes, that God remembered. God remembered. Did he forget? No, he never forgot. But we need to be aware that he does remember. And it's at that moment that he chooses to say, I am now going to step in and intercede. But he waits until the darkest hour before taking that first step. And so here it is now. The disciples are out and it's their darkest hour and the ship's being battered and they're alone. God's not even with them, it seems, because Jesus is on the shore, not even asleep in the boat, and their cell reception's terrible. and they can't call. And in that darkest hour, Jesus stops praying and he walks out to them. And he remembers them. In our darkest hour, God remembers us. That brings us to five. Sometimes, under stress, Jesus' presence can be viewed as a threat. Sometimes, when we're under enough stress and the storm is hard enough, God's intervention feels like an attack. That God's will is against us as well. Check this out, verse 26. It says, "And when the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified." They were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said. And they cried out in fear. It's a ghost. I have seen many times where people are struggling and they're hurting. And I try to tell them, hey, you know, God is with you. And they say, but I don't trust God's will. Because what he allows may be more than I want to appreciate. So I don't trust his will. That's basically what that phrase means. I don't know what God will allow. I don't know why he's not interceding. In other words, I don't trust him. He is a threat to me. He might allow more than I can endure. He might allow more than I can handle. He might allow more than I appreciate, more than I want. And we can sometimes view him as a threat. It's amazing how we tend to view God more like the Greek gods than the real God. Somebody who is just up there in the sky somewhere. Either he's a fairy in a turtleneck sweater, riding a trolley car, there to grant our wishes, or God is out there somewhere with a big old bag of lightning bolts just waiting to pounce. Either way, we have this weird view of God that is totally off kilter. And we're going to need to recorrect some of those thoughts, which we're going to be doing as we continue on. Just know that sometimes, under stress, Jesus' presence can be viewed as a threat. This brings us to verse 27 to 31. This is absolutely key. Most important point of the night is going to be this. You can sleep for 0.7. Actually, no, don't do that. But check this out, point 6, verses 27 to 31. We read the verses first. "But Jesus immediately said to them, 'Take courage.'" I love this. One of the most repeated commands in all of Scripture is do not be afraid. Love that. "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." Then there's Peter. Gotta love Peter, right? "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." I don't know who this guy thinks he is. I'm telling you, this boggles my mind. Because first off, regardless of standing on water or not, there's sharks in the water. Okay, so I'm not walking, I've seen Jaws. I'm not walking in any ocean, any lake. It's not happening, okay? Jesus is like, "Come on out in the water." I'd be like, "I'm fine right here. Thank you. I know you're God. Don't need to prove it." Yeah, I'm good. Okay, but Peter's like, "Lord, if it's you." If? That's a really weird if. If it's you? But that's really bizarre. What if a doctor says, "Well, if I know what I'm doing, this should go out well." If? See, I don't like the word if. If is iffy. Okay, I don't like it because it implies that it might not be. So it seems to be that Peter's willing to step out whether it's Jesus or not. Unless, of course, Peter's trying to manipulate Jesus. "Hey, Jesus, check this out, guys. Check this out. If it's really you," we know it is, "prove it. Let me walk out." I have no idea Peter's attitude here. It's really weird. But nonetheless, he calls out, "Let me join you on the water." And so Jesus says, "Cool. Come. Come on out. Let's see how it goes." Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. This is something that would even make Chris Angel just freak out, right? Because there's no magic trick involved here. There's no illusion or anything like that happening here. Okay, so here's a guy that's just walking it out. Okay, and I always wondered what this might look like. I have no idea because the waves are still going. So like he's like going up and down as he's walking. It's like staying on the water surface. You know, is he like ankle deep maybe? Just kind of, I mean, how does that work with the waves? Are the waves kind of moving around him and there's a lull spot? I mean, I don't know. It seems kind of weird. Okay, but nonetheless, this is just bizarre. So he walked on the water, came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, which is interesting, I've never seen the wind before. I imagine the rain's horizontal. We've seen that, right? Indiana's known for its horizontal rain around here. I've never seen rain in my life until I saw it rain here. I thought that, you know, I was like, okay, God, I'm watching the rain my first year here in Indiana, which is just last year. I'm watching one of the big storms hit. The tornado sirens are going. The rain is perfectly horizontal. And I'm looking at that going, holy cow. And I'm like, okay, God, I'm trusting you that you're not flooding the earth. Because holy cow. But then I got reminded, yeah, I'm not going to flood the earth, but that doesn't mean I can't do local flooding. And I'm like, ha, 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 that's funny, God. But nonetheless, I imagine horizontal rain happening. Okay, so he saw the wind, the rain just coming all around him, and was afraid. Okay, he saw the waves crashing around him. He saw all that was going on, and he became afraid and began to sink and cried out. It's interesting. How long did it take for him to start sinking the moment he took his eyes off of Christ? Immediately, right? How long does it take for us to go from a situation of obedience to a situation of sin? That's all it takes. Take your eyes off Christ. Your life can start sinking right there. Okay, so he began to sink and he cried out, Lord, save me! Which is ironic, isn't it? Because that's exactly what Jesus came for. Not just to save Peter now, but to save him eternally. So it's a really neat, ironic statement. This is where we all need to find ourselves at some point in our lives or another, to that point that we realize we can't do it on our own. And it's not about our will and our ability and our desires and our goals. It's about God. And we need to say, Lord, save me. And so he cried out, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus reached out his hand, caught him. You of little faith. I find that fascinating. How much faith did Peter have? That's what it seems like, right? After all, in the middle of the storm, first off, water freaks me out all by itself because of the fishies. Okay, but second of all, when you got a big old storm hitting, I'm getting life preservers and I'm getting as far away from the edge as possible and inside. And he's like, let me walk outside with you on the water. Okay, now that's huge. If any of you were out there in the water and I were to see you, I would not ask you to tell me to come to you so I can walk on the water to you. That wouldn't be happening. Okay, unless, of course, I'm wading in the water and I see a shark fin, I might walk for about 2 steps. But otherwise, it's not happening. I'm not getting out in the water. This is huge faith. And yet Jesus tells him, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Which shows that Jesus is also about end game. He's not so concerned about how you start. He's mostly concerned with how you finish. So Peter started well, but he finished poorly. And Jesus wants us to start however we start, but finish well. Get to that point that we persevere to the end. And if we're going to do that, there's a great little observation I would like to point out about this. And this one's absolutely huge. Check this out. That the water that threatens to be over your head are really beneath his feet. Think that through. The water that threatens to be over your head are beneath his feet. That no matter what you're going through, he is greater. That no matter how strong the storm is, the Savior is greater. No matter how much you think you can't do it, you're right, you can't. But with Jesus, he can. He can persevere you through it if necessary. He can grab you and lift you up if necessary, if that's what it takes, because we can't do it. We need him because he's the one who is walking on the water completely. So no matter what threatens you, no matter what threatens to destroy you, consume you, no matter what threatens to overpower you, all of it is beneath his feet. every single one. Check this out. Can a woman, Isaiah 49:15, can a woman forget her nursing child or lack compassion for the child of her womb? Yet even if these might forget, which would be a sign of great disturbance and selfishness beyond imagination, and we've seen it happen. Even if these forget, yet I, God the Father, will not forget you. 1 Corinthians 10:13, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to humanity. God is faithful, and he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation, he will provide a way of escape so that you will be able to bear it. And the moment you start thinking you can't handle it, God says, yes, you can. You just got to get your eyes on him more. Take your eyes off, you're right, you won't be able to. You're going to sink. But he always provides that way. That whatever you're struggling with, whatever even addiction you're struggling with, any of that storm that might be just trying to overwhelm you, there is a possibility of the way out. Because all of it is still beneath his feet. Point seven, in the midst of storms comes a great opportunity to either walk or fall. Either we're going to walk this and we're going to stay feet on the water, or we're going to sink in. Somehow, in one way or the other, it is going to absolutely be one or the other. Which is it going to be for you? Are you going to walk or are you going to fall? Every storm is that opportunity to find out. It's like a test, how well you do. You get that opportunity to find out. Not that long ago, I went through a very interesting storm. It was about a year and a half ago, July 2nd, 2016. Okay, so a year and a half ago, completely true story. This is really, most people here probably don't even know about this about me because I'm new here. I've only been here for about a year and a quarter. Anyway, nevertheless, July 2nd, I'm at the Grand Rapids Fireworks Show. Okay, and during that weird weekend of that year, everybody had fireworks on different days. So we could go on the 2nd, the 3rd, and the 4th. It was awesome. A lot of fireworks, right? So I went to the Grand Rapids Fireworks. And as we're putting our chairs on this hill to overlook the river where they launched the fireworks from in the city of Grand Rapids, Michigan, I started feeling weird inside my head. And it was a very odd feeling, like I was a little bit dizzy or tipsy. And I just thought, okay, I'm feeling like disoriented. Like I felt like things were tipping, moving, not quite spinning yet, but like they were getting ready to. And I felt like I wasn't really present at that moment. It was really weird. It was like I was experiencing a movie. Okay, and so I felt weird and I was having to sit in certain ways. I felt like my chair was gonna tip over while sitting on the hill, and I had to constantly reposition it. Very weird experience. And then in the middle of the night, about 3 a.m., I woke up and everything was spinning so fast and the dizziness was so extreme that I couldn't walk. So I actually rolled out of bed to the floor and crawled my way to the sofa, and I'm just sitting there trying to figure out how, and I'm doing my best not to wake up my wife, and I'm just sitting there trying to figure out how to get this from, and I've been dizzy before, but this was extreme. Okay, usually if I close my eyes, I focus really hard, I can get it to somehow slow down, but it wasn't working. And from 3 a.m. all the way through the day, all the way through the end of the night, it was still there, never slowed down, not even for a second. And so on July 3rd, that evening, my wife had to take my kids to go to the Holland fireworks by herself because I couldn't go. And so everything was just dizzy and spinning, and I was crawling over to the bathroom and I was throwing up because it was just so dizzy, I was getting motion sick. The July 4th came and it was still there all day, all night, not quitting, spinning. And about 6 a.m. on Friday morning, or on July 4th, I don't know if it was Friday or not, but on July 4th, at 6 a.m., I'm sitting in bed and everything just spinning. And all of a sudden it like stopped for a second, and then it felt like somebody kicked the bed, like literal force, bam, and I heard this noise in my head and everything spun really, really bad. And I went straight to the ground and started throwing up again. So I got rushed to the emergency room and they're trying to figure out what's going on. They're putting me up with IVs. I'm getting wheelchaired around because I can't walk. And by the way, that dizziness stayed with me for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weks, every day, all night, never, ever stopping. Come to find out, I had a nerve that went from my ear to my brain that had died. That was that snap sound. That was that moment that the bed got kicked. And I was in physical therapy, and they told me, yeah, you're gonna be dizzy for the rest of your life like this. It's never going away. I'm dizzy now. I went through physical therapy for 2 months to try to figure out how to walk again. to try to figure out how to actually talk again because it was so hard to talk. In fact, I didn't preach for 2 months. When I came here to candidate to preach the first sermon before you guys, that was my first sermon I had preached in months. And I had patches behind my ear to try to keep me from throwing up and all this stuff going on. And so I went through all this physical therapy. And one of the physical therapy exercises, this was a really big storm because I'm like, this is forever. There's no end to this. This is a permanent thorn in my side. They're like, you'll probably never be able to ride a bike again, never be able to roll the blade again. I can't play with my kids more than a half hour before I start getting sick to my stomach and get ready to throw up again. So I can play Barbies with my daughter. Half hour later, I got to quit and just go and put my head somewhere on the back of a pillow and just hold it there real still in order to get myself back to where I can walk again. And so it's a real, real bummer of a situation. But as I'm going through physical therapy, they told me, they said, as everything is spinning and spinning, you're gonna notice through physical therapy that you'll get it under control to the point of you'll notice, you'll know it's there, but you won't really notice it because you'll retrain your brain to understand it, except for when you get allergies or a cold. And of course, allergies don't exist in Indiana. Okay, and so I get these moments where it'll be there again. They told me whenever it comes, you need to find something on a wall that is absolutely solid. You need to stare at it. And then turn your head to the side, but let your eyes stay fixated on that solid object. And turn your head, and turn your head, then up, and then down. They said, whenever you're at, in the store, just start doing that. And then you gotta start walking heel toe while doing that. I'll tell you what, people leave you alone when you do that. Even employees don't ask me if they can help me. They just pretty much walk away. If there's an aisle I can't get through, I try doing that exercise just for fun. Clears it out. But here's the thing. That's what it's supposed to be like with Jesus. He's that solid something, that anchor for our faith. He's that solid something that we need to stay fixated upon when everything around us is spinning. When everything around us is in turmoil, he's that thing you can just look at. He's that thing we can just focus on because he's not moving. When everything else is unsure what's going to happen, we don't know if we're going to lose it out from under us. We don't know what's going to take place. We don't know if we're going to fall over, if it's going to consume us. But if we can just keep our eyes on Christ, we'll know where center is and we're going to be able to push it through. One last short little story and then we'll close. There was another individual that went through his storm a few years ago. His name was Stephen Curtis Chapman. He's a great singer. Love his music. Okay, I've been listening to him since the 1990s, the early 90s, like 92, I think is when I bought my first album from him. I mean, he's been around for a long time and he's still making awesome music even today. He's still doing it. It's an amazing gift. Well, he has lots of kids. He's got like 7 kids. Half of them are adopted because he loves adopting kids. Well, a few years ago, one day, his oldest son was getting in the car and they're backing out of the driveway. And one of his adopted little girls was playing in the yard and she ran out in the path of the vehicle. And I don't know if you know what, I can't even imagine what it would be like to have your own son run over your own daughter. You know, and then they take her to the emergency room and the doctors come out and they say, man, there's nothing we can do. And just knowing that everything, all the dreams you had for her to go to prom, all the dreams you had for her to be able to get married, to maybe have kids, to get a job, none of that's happening because she just died. And then to know that your own son is responsible but not responsible. But how do you handle that? Every time you look at your own son, you get reminded that he's the one that hit your daughter and backed her over. And when he's in that darkest part of his life, it's when he sat down with an ink pen and he wrote this song.
When you think you've hit the bottom, and the bottom gives way, and you fall into darkness no words can explain. You don't know how you make it out alive. Jesus will meet you there. And when the doctor says, I'm sorry, we don't know what else to do, and you're looking at your family wondering how they'll make it through. Whatever road this life takes you down, Jesus will meet you there. He knows the way to wherever you are. He knows the way to the depths of your heart. He knows the way, 'cause he's already been where you're going. Jesus will meet you there. Jury says guilty and the prison doors close. One you love says nothing but just packs up and goes. When sunlight comes and your world's still dark, Jesus will meet you there. When you failed again and all second chances have been used, and the heavy weight of guilt and shame is crushing down on you, and all you have is one last cry for help, Jesus will meet you there. He knows the way to wherever you are. He knows the way to the depths of your heart. He knows the way, 'cause he's already been where you're going. When you realize the dreams you've had, your child won't come true, and when the phone rings in the middle of the night with tragic news, whatever valley you must walk through, Jesus will meet you there. He will meet you there. Jesus will meet you there.